in Harlem. Any place in Harlem.
I am Tracy Hyder Suffern, and it is my great pleasure to serve as the executive director of the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. It's also my very great pleasure to introduce to each of you our new four-part Harlem Renaissance series. Our special guest, our very special guest for this series, is Dr. Robert G. O'Mealy, the Zora Neale Hurston Professor of English and Comparative Literature at Columbia University. Dr. O'Mealy is also the founder of Columbia's Center for Jazz Studies, which he led for many years. He's authored and edited numerous books on jazz and Black culture, including but certainly not limited to Lady Day, The Many Faces of Billie Holiday, Romare Bearden, A Black Odyssey, The Jazz Cadence of American Culture. As one of the world's foremost thinkers, he has researched and written about the early influence of jazz, 20th century Black genius, political thinking, the arts, Black expression, and rendering each of these topics exciting and digestible for the rest of us. We experience Bob O'Mealy here in conversation with National Jazz Museum in Harlem senior scholar Loren Schoenberg. Thank you so much for joining us. Along with our artistic directors, Christian McBride and John Batiste, I hope you'll go to the museum's event page to click on the many other expanded online and educational cultural programs we have to offer. Please visit us at jazzmuseuminharlem.org. Once again, that's jazzmuseuminharlem.org.
As our series continues, the Harlem Renaissance, a fresh look with Professor Robert G. O'Mealy, we turn to the legacy of Sterling A. Brown, who was an early mentor of Professor O'Mealy's. During the conversation, reference is made to Brown's great short poem about Ma Rainey, the legendary blues singer who was a mentor to Bessie Smith. Let's listen to Ma Rainey and then listen to Sterling Brown himself reading his poem, Ma Rainey, before we meet Professor O'Mealy, who will take us into his personal reflections.
Oh, his baby doing the widow, fight the money you love. Look out in the summer, you'll find your tika be gone. I said, but no man, no further than your eyes.
Ma Rainey. When Ma Rainey comes to town, folks from any place, miles around, from Cape Girardeau, Poplar Bluff, flocks in to hear Ma do her stuff. Comes flivvering in, or riding mules, or packed in trains, picnicking fools. That's what it's like for miles on down, to New Orleans, Delta, and Mobile Town, when Ma hits anywheres around. They comes to hear Ma Rainey from the Little River settlement, from black bottom cornrows and from lumber camps. They stumble in the hall, just a laughing and a cackling, cheering like roaring water, like wind in river swamps. And some jokers keeps their laughs a-going into crowded aisles, and some folks sits there waiting with their aches and miseries, till Ma comes out before 'em, a smiling gold-toothed smiles, and Long Boy ripples minors on the black and yellow keys. Oh, Ma Rainey, sing your song. Now you's back where you belong. Get way inside us. Keep us strong. Oh, Ma Rainey, lil and low. Sing us about the hard luck round our dough. Sing us about the lonesome road we must go. I talk to a fella and the fella say she just catch hold of us some kind of way. She sang backwater blues one day. It rained 4 days and the skies was dark as night, trouble taking place in the lowlands at night. Thundered and lightened and the storm began to roll, thousands of people ain't got no place to go. Then I went and stood upon some high old lonesome hill and looked down on the place where I used to live. And then the folks, they naturally bowed their heads and cried, bowed their heavy heads, shut their mouths up tight and cried. And Ma left the stage and followed some of the folks outside. There wasn't much more the fella say. She just gets hold of us that away.
Well, this is it makes my heart glad just to hear the name of Sterling Brown. He was my mentor and friend and a father figure, I would say, for me as a young professor. And before I was a professor, when as a graduate student, I was writing about Ralph Ellison, as you know, and there was nobody at Harvard when I was a student there who knew much about Ellison. They were not going to discourage me because they knew he was important, but they didn't know much about him. And my mother suggested that I call Sterling Brown from D.C., and she was still living there. And I said, well, you just don't call Sterling. Like, it would be like calling the Statue of Liberty. I couldn't imagine calling him. But he was listed. And I called him on the phone, and I told him what my topic was. And he said, whenever you're ready, come on down. And I began a series of meetings with the great man in his home in Northeast Washington. And he had reread Invisible Man in anticipation of my visit. He was already retired formally from Howard, though he would come back. And he, for him, I was a student, and it didn't matter if I was at Howard or at some high school or anywhere else. His responsibility as an adult in the community was to help me move forward. And so he did that. And my first article I ever published was the annotated bibliography of the works of Sterling Brown, because he's not well known. We don't know that he wrote all these poems and that he wrote essays and short stories and reviews. He put out a very important anthology called Negro Caravan. He was vital to so many people who took his courses in the 30s, 40s. He was teaching black literature before it was even a course. He did it as a series of lectures at Virginia Seminary, where he was before he was at Howard, and then at Howard, where they didn't believe in the black literature at that time. He taught it anyway, outside of that course of study. And so I revered him. Toni Morrison was his student. He was involved with the Howard Players and then with her as a member of that troupe and an important teacher. Leroy Jones, Baraka, said that it was the first time he realized that there was such a thing as black music that was a body of information. He went to Sterling's house, and on the wall were all of these records. And he said, oh my goodness, we have a tradition that goes from the folk stuff right on through. It's the work songs, it's the spirituals of the blue, then all the way up to Mingus and Ornette and the rest of them, Sterling. And so I revere him. He wouldn't mind saying that he suffered, that he suffered from bipolar disease. And so early in his career, he was unable to get his writing done. And there weren't the treatments that there were that there are now. And so there he was, middle 1930s, suffering from this disease. And it kept him from becoming the figure that we'd know now if he had a chance to get his writing done, I believe. He could write in fits and starts. He wouldn't like my saying this, but he tried to solve the problem with scotch, and that won't fix it.
Yeah.
The brilliancy of mind remained in flashes. He kept himself under control by main force. And one story I'll tell about him, and then we can leave him if you'd like. He spoke at Wesleyan when I taught there. And in the middle of his reading, he heard people in the back of the room rustling and making noise, a big group of students. And he was 82 years old. He turned around and sat back down. And I said, Prof, are you all right? What's happening? He said, if they don't want to hear these poems, I can go and I can get the train on back down to Washington. I can understand why they don't want to hear them. The very tough poems about lynching and about peonage and a jail system and the mightiness of Jack Johnson. And eventually he had absolute quiet. I said, people can leave if you want to. And nobody breathed even for about 5 minutes.
Sure.
And I'll end the story this way. When at the end of that reading, which he of course commenced, somebody said, frankly, Mr. Brown, your poems sound paranoid. You're always seeing these Klansmen and these others. What about that? And Sterling said, I'll say you one thing. If you're black in America and not paranoid, you're crazy. You're crazy. He was a tough guy, and he taught generations of people. And I invite people to look up the collected poems of Sterling Brown, and I think you'll find as great a book as you can pick up by anybody we've named yet. And Ma Rainey is one of them.
Well, this is
Little
what
Ma
I was
Rainey,
asking.
Little and
yeah.
Low.
Right.
Tell us about the hard times around your door. He presents her as a model artist. The blues singer working the chitlin circuits, these black tent meetings and shows that were not highly publicized outside of the circuits that they wrote on. He saw her as emblematic of what the poet's job was to do, which was to articulate the hard times that we're seeing and give us some hope through those lines of poetry. One thing Sterling said, I said, what about Archibald MacLeish, who said, a poem should not mean, but merely be? And Sterling, who was very funny, said, Bob, if a poem do not mean, a poem do not be, brother. And so he looked at Ma Rainey as somebody who had something to say in that the terse, compressed eloquence of the blues as a model of who we could be as citizens, telling the truth about what we were living through.
You know, he participated in the famous Christmas 1938, 1939 Spirituals to Swing concerts, which a lot of people are not aware that he was there.
Sterling was there, and he had been asked to help set the stage for these presentations of spirituals and blues singers and of the great jazz people that we know were on that set. And he defines the blues very eloquently there. And one thing he says, I believe it's there, is that he says that in the imitation blues you hear on Hollywood, it's the sadness that's feigned or pretended. It's pretend sadness in those fake blues. In the real blues, it's the humor that is feigned. The rest of it is just pure, pure sadness that we're trying to work through. And he had a great sense of humor, but he wasn't going to miss the tragic dimensions of the blues, the kind of thing, by the way, that our friend Albert Murray wouldn't care to have emphasized. Sterling Brown, I love, because he was not afraid to say, yes, we're joyous, and yes, we're celebrating, and yes, it's a ritual of continuity, but we're also telling the truth about the troubles that we've seen just in the blues. Sterling would say that the blues and the spirituals flow over the same bedrock of very, very hard experience. And I love his part in that. And I love the fact that for him, the spirituals, the blues, Benny Goodman, Count Basie, and Lester Young all fit together as part of a great American story. There are people who will lecture on the Harlem Renaissance and name the same three or four or five names over and over again, but there are many other names in the story. There are people who collected tales and songs like Edward C.L. Adams. Who knows who that is? Very important. There are people like Niles, who wrote very well about the music and collected very good versions of the blues that people rely on. People like Sterling Brown, whom we don't know about. The thing that fascinates me most about these unknown parts of the theater where we need to turn the lights on are that what fascinates me most there is that when we start to say, oh my goodness, what was different in sports and what was different in the writing by whites who were part of the team, like Van Vechten.
Yes.
That controversial, but very, very important. What about Nancy Cunard, who puts out a big book called Negro? She was part of the story. What was happening new in the sciences? What was happening new in politics? And what part does Jack Johnson, the great boxer, have to play in this story? I think it's very exciting to think about how to broaden our lens and see all of these forgotten women and men who are part of what made the period so exciting.
To get back to Hughes for a moment, Langston Hughes, an analogy I'd like to pass by you, that somehow his simple stories, era which were read by a wide swath of people, that maybe were analogous in a way to Ellington's pop tunes. Mm. And that Ellington, right up to the very end, wanted to keep that profile of a guy who wrote songs that people whistle and hum and live to. And then he also had time to write the other ones that that called for a different kind of engagement. I wouldn't even say more serious or more profound, a different kind of engagement, to be able to shove everything aside and actually concentrate for 20 or 45 minutes, which you don't have to do when you listen to Harlem Airshaft, or you don't have to do when you read a simple story. And even Hughes's use of the word simple, does that make sense? How does that resonate?
Well, I tell you, this is an answer you might not expect, but I grew up in Washington, D.C. during segregation. So the first 4 years of my schooling were in very strict legal segregation, if you can put it that way, in black neighborhood, black church, black school. And in Lucretia Mott School, named for the abolitionist, our day would start first grade, second grade, third grade, with a reading from African American poetry. We would read Little Brown Baby with Sparkling Eyes, Come to Your Pappy and Set on His Knee. What you been eating, son? Look like sand pies. Look at that face, you's as dirty as me. Paul Lawrence Dunbar, and somebody else would get up and say and read, well, son, I'll tell you, life for me ain't been no crystals. We would crystal stare. We would read something by Hughes. And so they entered the bloodstream of the community in that way. My parents were not really readers. They were smart people, and my mother was a school teacher, but she was not the kind who was always getting book review from the Washington Post or the Times and getting that new book. She had a copy of Simple Speaks His Mind as part of a library that included not that many books. She had children's books for us to learn from and the Bible and other things. But Hughes, like Dunbar, was just part of what you were supposed to know. And she read stories to us about Simple and his wearing out shoes and poking his foot through the window and this and that, when we were too young to have much of a context for that, but we recognized him as our own. And I think that just as for many people, Ellington, just name one, you know, the main, well, the kind of Duke-ish, or Cottontail, or things that you thought of as just put that on the jukebox or request, wait for that to be played by the band, and you want to dance to it. You didn't think of Ellington as our greatest composer of the century. That was just part of something that was part of the everyday culture that you could relax in leisure time to and just enjoy. And I think it took many people a moment to take the step and realize that even something like Mood Indigo could be scored for the 10-minute side of that album. It was at Ellington Uptown. And that something Concerto for Cootie was not misnamed. He's thinking of that as a concerto of a certain sort. And Such Sweet Thunder is a kind of a joke that it's a sweet piece of music, but he's doing a sweet. And he's, the thing I love about Albert Murray, since I've been a little critical of him, is, let me say this, is that he revered Duke for taking those 12-bar blues-based songs and 32-bar song form songs and building those into concert length pieces. He'd heard Beethoven and he knew Stravinsky and of course he Ravel and others, but he was really trying to take those building blocks from our communities, jam session ready pieces and Savoy ballroom dance pieces and build symphonies out of those. And so that when it came time for me, if I can make this analogy, to read a full piece by Hughes's piece called Ask Your Mama, you know, the full book length poem, or his book of stories, short stories, called Ways of White Folks. You got big challenging works. I could remember that I've known Rivers as a kind of building block from the kindergarten on, that I had loved him before I knew his name. And that was true of Duke as well.
I wonder from a literary angle, if there's any analogies to be made here, which is that you mentioned Ellington and the blues, and that I think one of the most significant things about what he did with the blues was he used, almost like in the sense of like a Joseph Albers painting, if you want to call them paintings, but blocks of color, that the blues were always 95% of the time, maybe 100% of the time, an element that was set in a context in Ellington's compositions, and that you could have a blues that was not 12 bars or 16 bars or 8 bars, and then he would use a different song structure to kind of highlight, almost like, you know, the contrast between tragedy and comedy, but to highlight it in a larger context. And I wonder, in Hughes's work, or Hurston's work, or in any of the writers that we associate with the Harlem Renaissance, if they were innovators in the structural formalistic aspect of writing, in the same way that Ellington really is sui generis, really, in many ways. Are there any writers in that sense that we can talk about from the Harlem Renaissance era?
Right from the beginning of the century, and from just before the beginning of the century, African-American intellectuals were saying, hey, you painters, sculptors, writers, look what the musicians are doing. We want you to do in literature what we see happening in the spirituals. And we want, where is the Duke Ellington of our literature? And you see that all through Elaine Locke and Du Bois and others, whether they were enamored of the blues as such or not, they could hear that this was something beautiful and something that captured the attention of their community and then communities around the world. And so I think that Hughes and Count Cullen had their eyes on Louis in particular and on Duke in particular, because they were so fantastically brilliant, you couldn't mistake it. Duke, for his part, was so generous. In one interview, he said he wanted to be the Count de Cullen of his music. In other words, he wanted to participate in the Harlem Renaissance. Cullen was by no means as great a musician or poet as Hughes or Hurston were in their own writings. But I do think that this was something that they all strived for. And in other words, to come up with something unique based on African American local experience. And that's what we see in those early books of Hughes, and then that's what we see all through the career. One reason I like to track the Harlem Renaissance beyond 1930 and beyond 1940 and on is I think that you find Ralph Ellison and Albert Murray and Toni Morrison and others, Gail Jones, trying their best to do this same thing, trying to say, what can we do that's as fresh as this? And they will even echo some of this. And I think James Will and John, right from the beginning, they're trying to come up with something new. And Toni Morrison, in a great speech, said, after Katrina, the tragedy in New Orleans, she went around reading to audiences, and she couldn't help noticing that she would give a reading, and there'd be very polite applause, and thank you, Miss Morrison. And then Bernice Reagan would get up and stop the show. Or then, you know, Sweet Honey and the great singer. Then there'd be an instrumentalist or a singer who would get up and move everybody. And Morrison said she wanted to do for her community what the musicians were doing. She wanted to give voice to those deep feelings. She was trying all her life. And she said she wanted a call response pattern in her writing. I think Hughes wanted that too. In Ask Your Mama, most particularly, and Ellison wanted that too, all through his work. She wanted something improvisational. Now, how are you going to make the letters standing still on a page imply a sense of improvisation? I think they all wanted that. And so I think the answer to your question is absolutely yes, and two answers I would give. One is that they wanted to honor those great creators that we've named, and they also wanted not just to imitate them and do what they did on the page, they wanted to imitate them in the sense that they came up with something fresh and something that sounded like the United States rollicking, and also, as Murray would say, confronting the fact that, as the blues say, that life is a low-down, dirty shame.
In this sense, I guess we can really call maybe Charles Mingus someone who kind of did more of those things than most anyone else, because he wrote famously, you know, Beneath the Underdog, and also would recite and play the piano and play the bass and do political things so famously. Maybe he's an ultimate scion of the Harlem Renaissance.
Well, what I would say to people who are listening and who teach the Harlem Renaissance is consider putting that record by Hughes on, Weary Blues, without forgetting that it's Charles Mingus that's on that record too. And to think about Mingus and just the kinds of things that you're talking about and his lifelong commitment to changing, to political statement making, his writings all through the years, his big compositions all through the years, and his playfulness with the blues. You're talking about Ellington and all the 8-bar blues. Sometimes it seems like 8.5-bar. You know, he wasn't stuck to 12-bar blues. He knew that it was a flexible form, and so did the great Charles Mingus. And I think making ourselves ask, what did this sophisticated movement stand for, and how can we see Aaron Douglas in painting and a Hughes together? And by the way, Aaron Douglas and Hughes did a series of projects for Opportunity Magazine where Aaron Douglas does the illustration, and there's Hughes's poem right with it. So I think they want us to recognize that they were together. These circuits were not that big. So if you got on the train to Chicago, you might sit next to Langston Hughes on his way there for a gig. The musicians today will tell you that they see one another on the road, and you might see the athletes in the back of the plane or the, you know, the, on the road, same thing. And that was all the more true during segregation time when your choices were so limited. So I think it's very right to ask ourselves about Jesse Owens as a runner, Althea Gibson as a tennis player, and what their power. Anybody traveling to Kansas City should stop in the Kansas City Museum of the Negro Leagues. And when they do that, they'll find that it's adjacent to the Kansas City Museum of Jazz.
The American Jazz Museum.
The American Jazz Museum. Let's get the title right. And these things belong together. I went to a tour of the Negro League part of the museum, and the guy giving a tour is someone whose name I don't remember, but he said he remembers seeing Josh Gibson. He said the difference between Josh Gibson and Babe Ruth is that Babe would hit the ball a long ways. It would go way out of the park and land out in the parking lot. And Josh would hit the ball and it would shift from second to third gear by the time it got out to the outfield. And then it would rise and just keep rising. And the ball was absolutely gone. It wasn't landing anywhere. He said, man, so there's a kind of storytelling tradition that goes on both sides of this. And then he reminded us that Cab Calloway had a baseball team, that Louis had his secret nine, they liked to play, and others. But more important than that, or just as important, is that the railroad systems were such that if you got on the train with the Cab Calloway band, you might run into Jack Johnson, or you might run into Althea Gibson, the great tennis player. You might see Langston Hughes on his way there. And so these folks were often on the set together. Randy Weston did a record and he hired Langston Hughes. So there he is, right on that same Uhuru Africa setting. And I think it's very enriching for us to remember that and to ask ourselves, what is the music in this painter's work that might have to do with the blues? What is the poetry in the blues that might remind us of Hughes? Hughes wrote his share of blues songs, if not too bad. His Backlash Blues, which Nina Simone sings, sound very, very real because he was accustomed to that idiom. And so I think if we look at ourselves, at the dynamism of these kinds of exchanges, and remember that they're all riding the same trains together again and again, we see more.
Years. What kind of influence outside of their own world, and you can define their own world any way that we want, it's not exclusively racial or geographic, but outside of what these great figures, and we're talking pretty much about Hurston and Hughes today, and a few others, of course, how large was their influence felt outside of the Harlem Renaissance figures? How did they influence major writers of their era and afterwards?
Well, this is a very good question, and one answer is offered, I think, in the novel called Jazz by Toni Morrison. There is a young woman, a teenager, who's babysitting her baby brother, an infant, and she cuts to a record store, and she sees an older woman. She said, "Will you watch the baby for just 1 minute?" And then she runs in the store to buy a Duke Ellington record called The Trombone Blues. And when she gets back, the woman has stolen her baby. And the other adults on the street say, "You better find that baby before your mama finds out about this. They left you left a whole live baby to go get an Ellington. You did what?" And eventually, of course, she gets the baby back. But one point for me of that scene is that this character, whose name I don't think we ever get, is as excited as she can be to hear this record that we never even heard of. And me, you probably did, and I hadn't. Trombone Blues by Duke Ellington. All she knew was that this was something new and something fresh, and that she wanted to dance to that music and she wanted to hear that. And I think the inspiration value of knowing that somebody who looks something like you could make you get up and dance and make you feel good about yourself and get up and look so elegant. Ellington looked like he was the prince. He's standing there next to Queen Elizabeth and he looks like he's the royalty and not her compared to, you know, the way she presented himself. The sense of life represented by a Louis Armstrong, a Zora Neale Hurston, a Langston Hughes, a Duke Ellington, inspired people whose names we don't know now. And I it's important to me that I think about certain of my relatives, my in-laws, who don't today know who Zora Neale Hurston was, but whose parents had a sense that there was something in the air that these great figures were part of that made them stand up a little straighter and made them decide that they were somebody important enough in this world to keep on keeping on. And I think that it's that invisible influence, running in to get a record, you're not even sure who Duke Ellington is, but you know that there's something vital on that vinyl. That effect, I think, is incalculable. By the way, Toni Morrison who says there's the drum beat of the sound. That's the muffled drums of the silent marchers against those killings in East St. Louis and elsewhere. The Red Summer killings. There's that march through the streets of the muffled drums, together with the good time music of people like Bessie and Lewis that come together that make for this new spirit that says, you know, I'm gonna stand up and fight for what has to be fought for, but hey, I'm also gonna have a good old time and do the Charleston at the Savoy Ballroom to the music of Ella Fitzgerald and Chick Webb and Duke Ellington.
In Harlem, any place in Harlem.